Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our January Benedictine conversation. This conversation is entitled The Wisdom of the Ancients. How do they speak to us today? And I'll be introducing our guest, Sister Laura Swan, in just a moment. I'm Dawn Carrillo. I'm the director of the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, which is a ministry of the Sisters of St. Scholastica here in Duluth, Minnesota. The format this evening will run similar to those that we have done before. If you haven't been with us, know that you can send in a question or a comment through chat. At any time, I'll be watching the chat box and I will incorporate your questions and comments into our conversation. So we're super excited to be with you as we start the new year together with Benedictine Conversations. So I would like to introduce our guest this evening, Sister Laura Swan, who comes to us from St. Placid Priory, which is a Benedictine monastery in the Pacific Northwest, the beautiful Pacific Northwest. Laura is a writer and spiritual director with degrees in theological studies and Christian ministry. And she has a particular interest in Benedictine and women's spirituality. And much of her work is focused on seeking to put women back into the stories that we tell of Christianity. She's the former prioress of her community, and she is currently serving as their formation director, as a spiritual director for the community, and the archivist, as well as doing some teaching at St. Martin's University in Washington State. And she says that for fun, she is a member of the Puget Sound Writers Guild and writes fiction, which is absolutely lovely. So Laura, I want to welcome you. Welcome to this space. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you for inviting me, Dawn. I'm delighted to be with you all.
I want to start us off with a quote that Sister Laura actually came across and asked me to use. So this is very appropriate for our conversation tonight. And it's written by Valerie Carr, who is a civil rights attorney and activist. And here she talks about listening, deep listening. So Valerie says the following: deep listening is an act of surrender. We risk being changed by what we hear. When I really want to hear another person's story, I try to leave my preconceptions at the door and draw close to their telling. I consciously quiet my thoughts and begin to listen with my senses. Empathy is cognitive and emotional. To inhabit another person's view of the world is to feel the world with them. The most critical part of listening is asking what is at stake for the other person. I try to understand what matters to them, not what I think matters. When the story is done, we must return to our skin, our own worldview, and notice how we have been changed by our visit. And so I ask myself, what is this story demanding of me? What will I do now that I know this?
Amen. Really apropos to the desert ascetics.
Yes, yes. Well, and I'm thinking of it too in terms of your story and us hearing about you. And I wonder if we couldn't start there, Laura, if we could start with you telling us a little bit about yourself. What would you like us to know about you?
That's always a hard question, because I think what you already told them as my introduction is more than I would ever normally reveal to people, just because I'm more of an introvert. I entered monastic life in my mid-30s, so it was not a first career, and brought with me my history, which included being my mother's daughter and my grandmother's daughter, granddaughter, and all the foremothers in my family tree. And I didn't even realize how assertive or confident they were until I started monastic studies with dear sister Lucy. And she would start telling me stories out of the desert, which is where monastic history began. And I would just start piping up, well, where are the women? Well, where are the women? Where are the women? And she would get frustrated with me and sent me off to find them myself. And that really started the whole journey. But I think my attraction to Benedictine life comes from the fact that my parents, even when they didn't have a lot of money, experienced God through beauty. We were always being hauled off to concerts in the park and to plays, and Ashland, Oregon, the Shakespeare Festival, largest repertory theater in North America, is a religious pilgrimage site for everyone in my extended family, that they experienced God through artwork and music and theater, and they passed that on to us. And that was really, in many ways, my attraction to Benedictine life, is that I had stumbled into Benedictine, did not know about them until my mid-30s, about us, but discovered that that is really a part of the ancient Benedictine tradition, is experiencing and really preaching the Holy Spirit, the divine, through the many different arts, which for me turned out to be writing. You do not want me to paint a picture or a fresco. It would be rather pathetic. I jokingly call it postmodern depressed, anything I would try to create. Just really bad hands or whatever. But I can appreciate other people's creativity if it's not something that I'm able to do. And so that really has been the attraction, and what in many ways has kept me here and has kept me connected with other Benedictine houses and with other people. Mm.
Thank you. Thank you. That's beautiful. Your background and your parents, how you said experiencing beauty mm-hmm. through music and art, experiencing God through that beauty, is very much something we talk about in our Benedictine conversations. So thank you for starting us with that. Thank you. So you just were talking a little bit about how you became interested in the stories of women that have been perhaps forgotten, is the word. Mm-hmm. You wrote this book called The Forgotten Desert Mothers. And it has to do with the women ancients in early Christianity who were sort of not talked about a whole lot. And I'm curious, was this also the time when you talked about the other sister that you were learning monastic studies from, that was this also the time that you became very drawn to the ancients?
Yeah. Monastic history does begin in the desert, really begins with the home churches that morph into monastic communities, and then the movement out into the desert. And when poor Sister Lucy couldn't give me names and information, I really did go on a hunt. Had no idea I was going to be writing a book. It was just a file in my filing cabinet. And every time I encountered one, I'd make copies and throw it at my drawer. And it just kind of grew over time. And I realized that there was actually a lot more out there, but people just were not paying attention. They were footnotes and endnotes and asides in early patristic articles and books. They were never directly the center of any scholar's research. But the information kept growing and growing and growing. And I was speaking at an Episcopal church north of here on Celtic spirituality. And we know that some of the early desert ascetics, when the desert was getting too crowded, took off to the ends of the earth, which is the west of Ireland. And mm-hmm. I mentioned that the desert ascetics actually probably were amongst the first to bring Christianity to Ireland, not St. Patrick. And I am Irish, so I can say that. A woman came up to me afterwards, no idea who she is. And she said, where did you find the Desert Mothers? And I explained that I had this growing file. And she said, looked at me and she said, you're going to write a book. And she turned around and she walked off. I knew she was absolutely correct. And I had no idea how you went about writing a book. And I just continued with my research and started pondering what a book could look like. And it just started emerging from there. It took about 5 years for it to come together because it was kind of like the data and the information had to talk to me about how you shape something like this. And I honestly thought it would last 2 or 3 years. I thought it'd be a short shelf life book. You know, not too many people seem to be interested in women and our contributions. And boy, have I been wrong all these years. It really hit a nerve somewhere along the way. And it's way more than me, but somehow this became a gateway for people to start exploring and to ponder. And so there's a lot more has come out since my book came out. And yes, they are forgotten. I was talking to one eminent scholar over the phone 25 years ago. And he's a scholar of Coptic. And he graciously sent me several stories. But he said, quote, we patristic scholars know all about these women. We just didn't think anyone would be interested. And I wanted to reach to the phone and wring his neck for making me go off and have to find all these women and to be able to tell their stories. And part of the organic is it became real evident that women collaborate. I don't want to sound stereotypical, but women do tend to collaborate. And so it was pretty evident that Desert Mothers were connected to deaconesses. Yes, there were deacons in the early church that have the female variety. They later on become gender specific. And that monastic communities tend to be the great supporters of the desert ascetics. And so that there was no way to tell one story without the other stories. And so that's how the book morphed into what it became, which is not just major and minor ammas, but also the deaconesses and some of the monastic foundations. Not a whole lot, but enough to give people a context.
Mm-hmm. You know, there's probably people in our audience this evening who don't know the story of the desert ascetics. So I wonder if you could give us a Cliff Note version.
Yeah, the Cliff Note version. Early Christianity met in home, and it wasn't even Christianity yet. Followers of the Way met in the homes and then came to temple to local synagogue for formal worship. Then with the destruction of the temple, everybody was meeting in homes, including the Jewish community. And Qumran, and there was a community outside of Alexandria who were Jewish ascetics, and Christians knew of them and knew of their way of life. As the Romans forced the dispersal of Jews out of Palestine, many of them went to the desert of present-day Turkey, Asia Minor, and to Egypt and down along the Nile to continue their way of life without interference from the Roman authorities. They actually literally moved 10 feet outside of the formal Roman border because they did not want to pay taxes to support a corrupt political system. Mm. They didn't want to get drafted in the military and they didn't want to support the military. But they went there to, they were both in small communities and alone, there to seek God and to try to discern. This is the time when they're trying to figure out what it means to be a Christian and how are we different from our Jewish neighbors? Mm-hmm. And the Christian texts are beginning to come together. And which of the 12 Gospels do we include in our new Christian texts when all 12 would be too wordy and all the other texts out there would be too wordy? And so they're beginning to, and the desert ascetics become part of this conversation around, you know, what are going to be the core essential texts as followers of the way, and then what are sacred texts, but not formally in what we now call the New Testament. But they were great keepers of the book. And don't you believe otherwise, those women had big libraries, because one of the ways they made a living was by copying manuscripts. So they get their hands on a history they like, and they make copies and sell them down in the local village and make good money. And they give 10% to the local deacon, who might be a man or a woman, to take care of orphans, widows, the poor, whatever needs to be done, buy their few supplies they need and back out to the desert. And usually they went in once a month, buy supplies, sell what they had to sell. But it became a way of life of how do we disengage from the Roman Empire with everything they experienced as corrupt to figure out how spirit was calling us to move into the future. Because they didn't have a clear path. You know, there was no 10-point program, and this is how the Christian community will now grow. Both Jews and Christians were struggling to figure out how to be this minority religion in the majority Roman Empire, and how do we do the good without participating in the evil? As I said, you know, slavery was rampant. Sexual promiscuity, what we call kids call today the hookup culture, was prominent. Political corruption, assassination. I mean, you name anything that is going on in the news today was going on back then. And then some environmental devastation. A lot of cultures disappeared. A lot of people died as a result of environmental devastation. War just is really bad for the environment, and Romans, their primary occupation was war, of one form or another. So it was this move to the desert to seek God, and to discern how we are called as followers of the way into the future.
So I am somewhat familiar with your book. I used it in my own doctoral studies, as I've told you. And I wonder if you could speak a little bit about what happened to them in the desert. Like, you know, how was it different for them? What qualities arose that were important to them that maybe weren't happening within the Roman Empire?
When you lived within the Roman Empire, especially if you were a person of any means, you had certain obligations to the emperor. I mean, you may just be merchant class, but you still had obligations. And those obligations would contradict gospel values, such as offering sacrifice to the Caesar's God or to Caesar himself. Christians and Jews were both known that if a child, you know, they practice infanticide. And so when a father of a family decided that the new baby was not going to be kept, they put him out on the back porch with the expectation that the dogs would haul him away and kill them. And so it was known that, if your neighbor has set a baby outside the back door, pick it up and take it to a local Christian or Jewish family, and they will either raise the child themselves or find a home with room for one more child. So they were already running into countercultural things with the Roman Empire, which could get them into trouble. I love the story of Olympias, who is a deacon in present-day Istanbul, Constantinople then, Byzantium, actually. Anyway, she was actually one of the singularly wealthiest women in the Roman Empire. She was related to the emperor by just like 2 degrees. She was the Melinda French Gates of her day. And when she decided to establish a monastery, she started giving her wealth away, and the emperor became livid with her. And it took some political maneuverings to keep her safe, because for her to give her wealth away threatened his position as emperor. He needed a certain amount of wealth to stay within the imperial family in order to stay in power. And she was literally undermining his position within the empire. And a number of the women we know about because they had to slip in and out in the middle of the night, either giving their wealth to deacons to redistribute or taking it with them and distributing it from the desert. And part of it was just clearing their minds and their hearts of the noise, the pollution, the demands on their time, so that they can sit and ponder what are the next steps for themselves and as well as for the Christian movement. Their goal was to become like the angels. Now, today, you know, we recognize the value of incarnation. And actually, they did then too. It's kind of like, we can do this too. I'm out here to become like the angels, and don't abuse your body. I'm out here to become like the angels, and it's important to remember the poor, the orphan, the widow. It's kind of like both at the same time, a paradox that they lived with and were quite comfortable with.
Wow. So I'm curious then how Benedict fits into this story.
Well, Benedict certainly knew his desert tradition. A guy by the name of John Cashin had lived in the northern Egypt area with some of the desert fathers, and he learned from them. And he actually went around kind of like a tour guide of Egypt to collect the stories, the sayings, everything he could get his hands on to understand their teachings about prayer or fasting or really how to get along with each other. There certainly was no modeling by the Roman Empire. And so one of the things the desert mothers and fathers were doing was trying to teach people how to get along with each other graciously. He comes around the empire to Gaul, which is now southern France, and sets up a couple of monasteries there. And so Benedict, in his young seeking for God, somehow came across the writings of John Cashin, the fathers of Lyrian. He ran across Basil the Great, who is not the father of Eastern monasticism. His older sister Macrina is. Macrina was the one who set up the monasteries. Macrina went after her brothers who were putting off baptism and taking their faith seriously. They were off studying in Rome and doing whatever else. And she finally cajoles them back home and into the monastery and starts training them in the monastic way. Now the Orthodox world does acknowledge that Macrina, the younger, is actually the founder of Orthodox monasticism, not Basil, her younger brother, who was in himself, had a good mind, as did his brother and his cousin, but she's the founder. That's the sort of thing about the forgotten. We rewrite the history so that we write the women out and put the men in. And I like guys. So this is not a diatribe against men, but just what has happened historically. So Benedict knew the desert tradition. He knew the teachings of these people. And really, between that and the rule of the master, it was so convoluted. And he knew that once he got hauled out of his hermitage and was convinced he had to start reforming some monasteries, that he had to come up with something real basic, because he was welcoming everyone into his monastery, the Crips and the Bloods and the patrician class and former slaves. And how do you level the playing ground? And so he was taking the best of the desert and monastic tradition, kind of like monasticism for dummies, and created just a very basic rule. And it says at the end, and once you've mastered this, then you go on to all these great writers who will teach you more, Augustine, you know, Cashin, et cetera, who will bring you to a greater maturity in your monastic observance. But he knew he had to have something really basic. Like, for instance, Americans for a long time thought, oh, isn't it sweet? Benedict didn't want his monks to cut themselves. So there's a little line in the rule about have the monks take the knives away from the monks before they go to bed. And we all assumed it was because they might roll over and cut themselves. And the great Benedictine scholar Aquinata Bachmann from Germany looked at us and said, your cousin three times removed insulted my cousin three times removed, and vendetta requires that I slip a knife into your between your rib cage while you're sleeping. I mean, this was the kind of character he had in this monastery, that he had to keep them from killing each other.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's amazing. So when you're, the title of your book, The Forgotten Desert Mothers, you said just a second ago, what it sounds like what you mean by forgotten, that they're forgotten, that women have been forgotten. You said we rewrite the stories and leave the women out.
Okay. What is that great saying? The victors of the war write the history.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want to call it a war, but patriarchy, misogyny does not come from Judaism. They were a part of the same, breathing the same air as all their neighbors. And it really comes out of Greek and several other cultures, much older. And it was a basic hatred of women for being women. And when Christianity first began, scholars tell us that it was primarily a woman's movement, but especially when Constantine comes along and legalizes Christianity, all of a sudden, scholars tell us, men started realizing that priesthood, presiding, you know, priesthood isn't quite what we call it today, but priesthood, you know, being a public leader is a way to gain power, even if I wasn't born into the proper class to gain power. And all of a sudden, they're pushing women out of leadership and putting themselves into leadership. You know, in the earliest days, not only did we have women deacons, but we had women basically bishops. They were teaching, they were preaching, they were doing anything that the guys were doing, because, you know, the thinking was we need to get as many people converted as possible before Jesus returns. So they were not worried about church structure. That comes along later on. And even that's just a slow growth. But, you know, the Greeks believed that women were malformed men. And so, you know,
malformed
men. Yeah. And actually, dear Thomas Aquinas will pick up on that again. But we've got a history of the assumption is women did nothing. Women did not contribute anything. We have scholars will point out all sorts of examples where a woman's name was changed into a man's name,
right,
when the manuscript was copied and passed on. I tease my students when I teach church history that women are the source of all sexual sin. That's the level, the lens through which we can study church history. And the guys chuckle and laugh, and the girls kind of screw their face up, wondering if I'm serious or kidding, which I think is kind of cute. But really, it has been just a long history of course women didn't preside. Of course women didn't preach. Of course women weren't deacons. Of course, of course, of course. So we rewrite everything to only show what the men do. And this is where we get this whole business of women need to be only in the home under a father, a brother, a husband, or a son, and or in a cloister. So they're always trying to inflict cloister on women. But for women, it's a grill. And for men, it's just a part of the monastery that's not open to the public. But we have a part of the monastery not open to the public, but we don't have a grill. But the grill, which they never were successful in consistently enforcing on us, was there to try to control our sexuality, because our sexuality will get so out of control. And then those poor chaplains and any visiting dignitaries will be attacked by us, and I'm being sarcastic right now, and knock them to the ground and seduce them, because that's just all what we're filled with.
So you think that's what's underneath all this?
Misogyny, patriarchy. And then if you're trained, you know, as the centuries go on, if you're trained to only see men, you're going to continue to only see men. And then you treat someone like a Hildegard or a Heloise as an extraordinary exception to the rule. No, but that's the way they get treated. I still see books published in the last year or two on the history of Western monastic orders, and women might rate 3 paragraphs out of a 500-600 page book by a certain press here in the United States is my latest example.
So it's a power play, and a fear of sexuality and all. Yeah. Wow.
And then eventually it just becomes ignorance. They just don't think to ask.
Yeah.
Now, young scholars are breaking a lot of that down, which is great.
Mm-hmm.
They're going beyond the tradition they received, and they're going back to archives in Europe, and they're sitting there and going through page after page after page, looking for what actually was going on as opposed to what they were taught or read in the history books. And so they're doing wonderful work. I can hardly keep up with them.
Well, that's encouraging and very, very helpful. You know, in the opening little passage that I read by Valerie Carr, there's this one line where she says, to inhabit another's view of the world is to feel the world with them. So a lot of what I'm hearing from you is helping me to feel the world of the ancients. And so I want to explore that a little bit, in particular the desert. And I have a passage from your book, The Forgotten Desert Mothers, that I'd like to read to start us off with this. And this is Sister Laura is talking about some reflection during her graduate studies. And here's what she says. I came to know the desert intimately and all its painful stripping and intense silence. With time, I learned to listen deep within. What had seemed barren was transformed into abundant simplicity. Mm-hmm. The deafening silence and the apparent absence of God revealed the idols I held dear. God yearned to strip away all my false gods so that I might encounter the authentic I am. My interior journey was toward inner simplicity, toward fertile soil from whence my truest self might emerge. What I hear you doing there is taking the wisdom of the ancients and applying it within your own heart, within your own life. So I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit more about the desert. You know, what is the desert for us?
The desert is obviously not just a barren space with no vegetation, no life, although a portion of it, that is certainly true. And when you go out into a desert, at first it can look dry and ugly and barren, and then all of a sudden the beauty starts emerging. You know, the small flowers and the small critters and the different colors in the stone and how the sun reflects off the sand or off the dirt or, you know, whatever kind of a desert you're in, which is what drew the ascetics to Egypt along the Nile River or to Asia Minor or Persia, because present-day Iran, Iraq were also places that hosted a lot of desert ascetics. It starts becoming the place of our interior desert, which is stripping away all that keeps us from an intimate relationship with the divine. And so sometimes that is, you know, quite painful. It certainly was true for me. The woman I joined the monastery with, unfortunately, committed suicide. And that was certainly an experience. My mother was diagnosed with stage 4 breast cancer, like a month later. Our monastery, the one I'm in now, was supposed to be constructed and it hadn't gotten going yet. So we went out into diaspora and I joked that I didn't know, going off to graduate school, I didn't know where home was going to be from one week to the next, based on being out there until this monastery could get built. But probably the most painful is that I know my sisters probably wouldn't believe me, but I had very rigid conservative ideas about how the world was supposed to be, exactly who God was, how the church was supposed to be, what everybody was supposed to believe. You know, I had it nice and neat and tidy, all in this great box. And with all those and other things that happened, my world just got stripped apart, imploded. You know, all my idols literally came crashing down. The God I thought I knew, no more. How this community was supposed to be, no more. Where we were supposed to be wasn't even quite defined yet. My family, you know, going through, my father had died before my mother. We went through a whole new negotiating or playing out of how we were going to relate to each other. We're a small family. Everything just came crumbling down. And I started hearing, well, my first trip was to Cuernavaca, Mexico with my graduate program, and then El Salvador, coming to experiences of places with poverty and injustice that was not their fault. I had this idea that people are poor because they're lazy. That was my yeah. old, and my new was, oh my God, this is just so not true. One of the things I love about Black Life Matters and the Me Too movement is their chant of say their name. It's just like, name our reality, name our idols, let go of them once we become aware of them. And just even hints of being aware of them. To make it this very concrete and specific, but the desert as a place of barren, no life, starts emerging as a very beautiful place, to a point where really they didn't want to go back into the city. And lots of people who, once they've experienced their own desert, don't want to go back to where they'd been before. And oftentimes it starts with external things. I sit with people in spiritual direction. They're encountering the next level of their desert. And next thing I hear is, you know, pickup trucks of junk in their house are getting hauled up. They're doing the first easy step, which is cleaning out closets, cleaning out attics. And then it's the next step and the next step and the next step towards simplicity.
Wow. So you would say that we all experience these deserts, whether we know they're deserts or not.
Yes. And I think God will let us sit out in our desert, even with our eyes closed and our ears plugged and everything else, denying that that's where we are, until we're really ready to finally open up our eyes. And that's where a mentor is important, because of course we know people can experience despair or depression. And if they don't have someone around them to guide them, both obviously a counselor, but also a spiritual mentor, it can be, you know, quite tragic. But depression and despair really can be signs that there is a call in your life to deepen something. I kind of liken the journey, the spiritual journey, as 1 foot long and 7 miles deep, that it's not really going that away. It's going down within ourselves and into the divine.
Wow. I'm intrigued with these forgotten women. Now, you mentioned the one story about Olympus.
Olympias.
And I'm wondering if there's other stories that you could share with us, a couple of stories that have been important for you.
Out of the desert or anywhere in
wherever history. Forgotten women.
Oh, they're all over the place. My more recent book is called Wisdom of the Beguines. And yes. Beguine was a nickname, originally an insult, which quickly became a compliment. And it was a movement all over the Europe by many different local names. But a cardinal at that time said, different names, same reality, Beguine, which was women who did not want or could not enter a monastery because limited space, but who really felt called to ministry according, you know, following the gospel in the way they felt called, and not to be in a monastery. And they set up homes, sharing houses together. Beguinages was the term, and different names in other parts of Europe. But they also knew that they wanted and needed to be self-supporting. So they became great businesswomen. In the north, they were famous for going from shearing the sheep all the way to finished products. Great weavers. They would teach women who were coming in off the street who were in danger of being, you know, sucked into prostitution. They'd bring them into their homes and teach them one step of this, the whole process, whereas they were massively creating all these products. In Paris and northern Italy, it was linen and silk. Same idea, from raw to finished products that they would sell to the aristocracy and the royal family. They oftentimes actually had royalty in their corner who liked what they were doing, because they used the money. They were also financial wheelers and dealers, what today we would call making loans, changing money on the international exchange, that sort of thing. And they would use the money to open and run schools, to open hospitals, which could be both a hospice and medical and a place for the homeless until a more secure place could be found. They built what we would call a townhouse in the United States. They're up and they're narrow, and they would build them in circles. And in the inside would be a courtyard with grass and trees, and they would have a sheep and cattle there, and they'd have their beer making facility and their beehives, and always built along a canal because that was the highway of their day. This was true in Spain and northern Italy and France as well. And they were just wheeling dealing on a big time level. So they were in a lot of trouble with not so much the church a little bit, most, but the church really liked what they were doing for the poor and for educating children, because it was known that people who could do some basic reading and writing not only could read their catechism and their prayer book or whatever, they made more money. So the economy improved, and so more taxes could be collected. Mm-hmm. And the women were wise. They did not claim tax exemption through the church. they paid their fair share of taxes so that when a duke or a somebody or a bishop wanted to go after them, the town aldermen were their greatest defenders because they didn't want to lose the tax base. But they translated scripture into the local vernacular. They preached. They taught. They would do things like go out onto the corners on market day and do puppet shows to teach, you know, attract kids and teach them basic Bible stories. Very independent women, hugely influential in theology. Corpus Christi is a Catholic solemnity or feast, whatever it is, that was actually started by a woman, not a bishop. It was started by a woman. She preached it in Northern Europe. This one Italian bishop caught wind of it, thought it was a great idea. He gets credited for establishing the Feast of Corpus Christi. You know, go figure.
I mean, this goes on. What centuries are we talking about here?
I focus primarily on 1200s to 1400s.
Okay.
But there are still Beguines today. I'm going to be speaking in October in Northwest Germany at the second international conference on the Beguines. There are Beguine communities forming again. And they set their own rule, just like they did back in medieval ages. The biggest thing that actually compromised the Beguines was not even actually the French Revolution. It was the secularization of the 1800s. Napoleon and company stole all their land, their buildings, their contents, and pay off political bribes. And so they just regrouped elsewhere. But really, by then, the numbers were beginning to shrink down because of the devastation, you know, of what happened. But I focused pretty much on 1200 to about 1400, 1450.
That's right, fascinating. It's fascinating that they're still around today. Wow.
I've heard from Australia, from Ireland, from Germany, and I'm sure there's more. That's just who I've heard from.
Right, right. I am wondering, the stories about the ancient ammas and abbas seem very apropos to our lives today in terms of the political situation, the economic situation. There was oppression, which is what they were fleeing, or not fleeing, but they were consciously, intentionally leaving.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering, what can they teach us for our own stories today?
Sure. Benedict's chapter 7 on humility really does come out of the desert, not word for word, but it comes out of the desert tradition. And that was a key theme for the ascetics, that if you want to discern God's calling in your life, if you want to grow in imaging the likeness of Christ, you're going to start letting go of your pride, which also can be low self-esteem. You're going to really look at what is triggering you, that you don't feel like that who you are as you are is okay. And then yet we're also trying to grow into Christ. I think they would speak to us today about the importance of discernment. You know, I know that social media and phones, I don't own a phone, just want to make that publicly known. Don't want to own one, but those can be good tools for any ministry or work we're doing, but to get sucked into them. I mean, we now know depression and anxiety is just rampant amongst young people. Part of it is their addiction to these things. That somehow we need to step back from the roiling activity of our life, and roiling is not necessarily bad, to how do we actually hear? That's why silence is so important. Taking some time for solitude is important. As I tell my students, listening, which is why I love the quote you opened with, is the singularly most dangerous thing we will ever do, because we will be changed. If we actually listen, we will be changed. There is no conversion without listening.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you know, the great story of Paul on the road to Damascus, it sounds like he was on a roll and then suddenly something happens, but there had to have been a part of him within. And I know that Pharisees get a bad rap, and the majority of the rabbis who followed Jesus were actually Pharisees who embraced the new movement. Mm-hmm. There had to have been something within him that was still open to the unexpected from God. And the importance of prayer whatever form that takes, and it can take many different forms, as a way of anchoring our life so that we're not thrown about, you know, by all the vicissitudes of life. I love what Pope Francis likes to remind us of, all of us, is that we were made for joy. That is the Holy Spirit within our life, that even in really hard times, a deep abiding presence of joy is the presence of divine, but to also never lose hope. Sometimes the sayings of some of the desert ascetics can sound kind of harsh, kind of grumbly, growly personalities there. But in some ways, they were challenging their hearer. Are you here just to be a looky-loo and to go home and say, I did lunch with Syncletica, you know, a little feather on my cap? Or are you actually here for a serious reason? And so, you know, Benedict's knock on the door for 3 days before you let them into the monastery was kind of the desert ascetics rebuffing of someone who might initially come, especially if they sense a sense of self-importance. You know, I am here now, so of course you want to set your schedule aside because I am here, as opposed to a very humble seeking person. You know, the poor, you know, would receive a very different welcome by the desert ascetics. So if you're offended by one of the sayings, good. Go back and find out why. Me too, of course, but go back and find out why.
Do you have a favorite one, a favorite saying?
Oh, it isn't one of the mothers, it's one of the abbas, but I love this, the saying of become fire, you know, prayer as just become fire, that one of the abbas was seen all throughout the night, and he was standing in the orante position, and he had just become like fire. And in the morning came, and that went away, and he was right back to making his rope and soaking his beans and doing his work. But really, that's what the over throughout history, men and women have been trying to challenge us to catch on fire, you know, get exuberant for the gospel, the good news. Be people of joy, not of miserly, miserable, you know, countenance, and important.
Well, and the joy thing is, it's interesting to think about that because the desert's harsh. The desert's, the desert's tough to navigate. And we have a couple of messages that have come in from Kathy, a question for you. Who is the desert mother whom you feel most influenced by?
Probably Syncletica, because in some of her sayings, she really is not only, she's really kind of explaining, to me at least, what it means to be a good spiritual director, what it means to be a good companion. But she also says some pretty tough things, which I think is great. But it's probably Syncletica. There actually are two Syncleticas. There's one in Palestine and one in Egypt. So I've got them both in the book. But Syncletica in Egypt is probably a favorite of mine. And she does address the issue of humility. And I needed more than just a little bit when I first began this newest round of my journey when I joined the monastery.
We have another comment from Greg. My mother was the primary passer on of the faith. She had no power within our Roman Catholic tradition, yet was monumental, along with the good Benedictine Sisters of St. Scholastica, to my introduction to the gospel and to the social ministry of the gospel. How can we deal with the ongoing patriarchy and misogyny of today, keeping our hope?
Yeah. There was a book in 1990 whose title has always stayed with me. It was a series of articles by women theologians and biblical scholars on why they stay in the Catholic Church. Mm. And it's called Defecting in Place. Mm-hmm. Love that image of defecting in place, of all the good people leave, what's left behind. We are more powerful than we give ourselves credit for. To gently challenge pastors and pastoral leaders, to gently challenge even our bishops and archbishops, over, you know, what really is important here. Seattle is archdiocese is kind of known for shaping bishops. So Rome only sends the not toughest, but the ones most astute, because Seattle is not going to take any flack. And we've pressed over the years through many bishops, a preferential option for the poor, care for the immigrant, which our current bishop is right on board with. He is trying to expand the roles of women in ministry. He is restoring lay ecclesial ministry training, which two bishops had let go of, but the wonderful Raymond Hunthausen had started up years ago. So, you know, being willing to, first of all, be willing to share with whomever God puts across your path as a mentor. The teenager, we so forget the teenager that's in our neighborhood, who hangs out at our parish, who's, you know, at youth ministry, you know, just even if they're not yours, to take the time to listen to them and to chat, and because they set an example. These kids really are looking for people to emulate and mentor, and to allow yourselves in whatever way the Holy Spirit chooses to become that person. Again, with the 20-somethings, to down at the coffee shop, you recognize a few long-lost kids and invite them to come back and be a part of the solution. I do think this synodality process has the means of shaking the church awake in so many ways. The challenge, as you know, is it's not just the United States. It's Africa. It's South America. It's Southeast Asia. It's Australia. It's, you know, wherever. We are a global church, so that women's issues in Africa are closer to survival as opposed to white upper middle class people in the United States. And that doesn't mean we don't have our woes, because that was me. I was white, I'm still white, but upper middle class before I joined the monastery, and very well educated. So a place of privilege, but still can be a model for change in the church. And of course, the mothers are the ones who, not dads don't, but mothers are oftentimes the backbone of faith for so many families, and not just in the Catholic Church.
It's something else that strikes me in this question of Greg's dealing with ongoing patriarchy and misogyny. I think about the ammas and the abbas in the early church, or in the first few hundred years. And I think about their witness, their prophetic witness for leaving the trappings of the city and going to this harsh desert. And, you know, there's something very that speaks to me of truth and integrity in their lives. And so I think about that with what Greg has asked about patriarchy and misogyny, and a dear friend of mine at the monastery here in Duluth, who will say to me, stand in your truth, stand in your truth. And that's a scary thing when we are up against church structure, and when we're up against learned scholars who say things like, oh, well, we didn't think anyone would be interested in the stories of the women, you know. So it's something I think we're being called to in this moment, to be people of truth and people of integrity. And it's scary, but it feels good when you do it.
Yes, and there's actually more of us out there. And so it's really important for people to connect with like-minded people. Not that we're just always hearing what we want to hear from each other, but there are people all over this country who are a part of wanting to be the next reform movement within the Catholic Church, which of course begins with us, and then, you know, out into our parish communities. That gentleman I mentioned, he's become my great defender when scholars say, oh, the women weren't very important in the desert. They had very little impact. And he will come back and say, no, that's actually not true. Wow. So he's come around once he realized that, yeah, there was a huge interest in this piece of our church history. So don't lose hope that people really do change And a lot of it is just about, like with the whole racism question today in the United States, too many white folks simply did not know their U.S. history. They did not know what African-Americans lived through, what Asian-Americans lived through, what indigenous people lived through. That's the, I don't want to call it beauty, but the beauty of the boarding school investigations is we're putting names and faces to what happened. And the change is only going to happen when we stop choosing to be historically ignorant. And so a good ascetical practice is to go down to the library and ask the librarian to send me to a book that I would never pick up and read on a piece of history that I know nothing about. And there's just great young scholars writing all sorts of good stuff right now if people would just take an interest.
Well, and that's what I see as so critical about your work. You're raising awareness. What you're talking about right now is raising people's awareness. And there's that happens on an individual basis and a collective basis. And
yes,
yeah.
So. And there is a bibliography in the back if people want to read something besides me, you know, in terms of recouping some of this history.
Susan says, thank you so much for sharing your insights and history with us. This has just been fantastic. I could listen to you for hours, she says. Yeah.
I'm going to remember that the next time I'm in the classroom teaching and my students want to have their noses in their e-devices.
Well, this has been fascinating, and we're about at the end of our hour. This has flown by. It was just so wonderful talking with you, Laura, and there's so many other directions I would love to go, but I want to just thank you for being here. I want to thank everybody for participating and being a part of this really important conversation. That goes all the way back to Eve, right? Mm-hmm. And our interpretation of Eve. We've been talking about that recently. So thank you so much. And thank you for your passion and for your work in this area, Laura. And I'm wondering, I'm wondering if what you'd like to leave us with this evening, what words you'd like to leave us with.
There is always hope. And the divine is always there awaiting us as we are willing to move closer and closer and closer.
Thank you. That's beautiful. So on behalf of the Sisters of Saint Scholastica and the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, to you, Sister Laura, to all those who have joined us this evening, blessings and of peace and joy to you and your loved ones. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.